Good afternoon, one and all, and welcome to another session of Learn from the Masters. For today's session, we'll have one of our consultants, who is a consultant in the Department of Orbit and Oculoplasty at Shankara Eye Center, Indore, and Dr. Shweta will be talking on ptosis evaluation and management. Over to you, Dr. Shweta.
Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity to present at this platform. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope you are all doing well. So I would be discussing about the ptosis, its evaluation and management. It is a very vast topic, but I would like to cover the slit, the clinical pulse and the pointers. So in my talk, I'll start by giving the insight about the need for understanding of the ptosis. I will cover the relevant applied anatomy and the logical approach, evaluation and documentation, etiopathogenesis and classification, and finally we'll end up with the management. So why there is a need for thorough understanding in the case of ptosis? It is relatively common, often overlooked and underreported symptom, as well as a clinical sign. The disease causing the ptosis can vary in severity from long-standing involution processes to the life-threatening emergencies. This is not mere a cosmetic concern. The ptosis carries a significant morbidity with it. The patient tend to lift their eyelids in order to see clearly, which results in brow ache, headache, and heavy eyes. Also, they have the development of forehead furrows and rhytids. They often complain that their relatives as well as their close friends are pointing towards their tired look. Apart from this, the patients also present with the loss of superior visual field. So blepharoptosis is the scientific term described for the ptosis of the upper lid, where the lid is displaced below its normal position, which is 1.5 to 2 millimeter inferior to the upper limbus when the eye is in the primary position. So as you know, the basic anatomy of the levator malleus and frontalis muscles, which are the chief elevators of the eyelid, I will describe some relevant clinical anatomy here. As the levator enters into the eyelid, the anterior fibers attach to the septa between the orbicularis muscles. The posterior thick part attaches to the anterior surface of the tarsal plate in the 2.5 to 4 millimeter of the superior part. Also, there is projection of some levator fibers to the suspensory ligament of the superior fornix. Anterior to the levator, there are preaponeuritic fat pads. There are two fat pads in the upper lid. One is medial and one is central. There is expansion of levator inferiorly in the horizontal expansions, which leads to the formation of medial horn and the lateral horn. Why they are important? Because they are in close relationship with the superior oblique muscle medially and lacrimal gland temporally. So it is very important to look for this relationship when we are dealing with the supramaximal levator resection. So further, anteriorly, this preaponeuritic fat pads are covered by the orbital septum all over. So the approach to a case of ptosis starts with the identification of the cause, and you should ensure that there is no serious underlying neurological cause. So it's always advisable to document the triad of lid position, pupillary size and reactivity, and extraocular motility. So the complete history includes the mode of onset, progression, duration, whether it is unilateral or bilateral, if it is bilateral, whether it is simultaneous or subsequent, and whether it is a complaint of diplopia. So this is the comprehensive checklist to be documented in a case of ptosis. So whether there are any precipitating factors, which includes the previous eye disease, such as dryness, allergy, BKC, GPC, thyroid eye disease, or there is any ocular infection, surgery, trauma, or contact lens use. Are there any associated symptoms such as jaw winking, dysphagia, dyspnea, dysphonia, any fatigue, difficulty in getting up from the chair? The medication history is particularly important in case of statins. Any history of any surgery, any history of variability, aggravating and relieving factors, severity, and family history, which are particularly important in cases of congenital ptosis, myopathies, and blepharophimosis. So this is the patient, 10-year-old boy presented with leptitosis since 2 years. He had very good levator function and he has a slightly higher level of the lid crease. So it was not correlating with the congenital ptosis. On detailed examination and history, the patient gave history of excessive rubbing of the eyes due to VKC. And the old pictures of the photograph also did not show any sign of any congenital or pre-existing ptosis. So in such cases, the review of patient's old photographs are very important to establish a diagnosis. So just like in general medicine, you are told to complete the examination from head to toe. In oculoplasty, the examination is told to be is considered to be complete when it is done from the vertex to the chin. So you should always document if there is any facial asymmetry, if there is any facial palsy or presence of any spasms. So here in the first photograph, you can easily see and make out the hypoplasia in the left side of the face. In the second patient, you can see she presented with right eye myelitosis, but on examination of her complete face, you can see there is a mild weakness in the right side of the face and that she has some evolving facial palsy. Also, the abnormal head posture should be documented in all cases of ptosis. In order to lift their eyelids, they frequently use their frontalis muscles, which leads to the formation of forehead creases. The eyebrows are also very important to document in a case of ptosis, and you should document the position and contour. Here in this second image, you can see the eyelid is at a higher level, and there are few faint horizontal forehead creases. So the signs of periocular and eyelid inflammation should be looked for in any case of ptosis. Especially to mention here is the blepharocalysis, which is the recurrent, which is the disease in entirety, similar to the angiodiuretic edema, which presents with the recurrent episodes of inflammation, especially in the young females, and it involves one eye. They present with eyelid swelling. Here you can see in the left side with myelitosis, and the lid skin shows typical cigarette paper appearance. They may have slight dilated vessels over the lid and the prolapse of lacrimal gland. Once the disease settles and it becomes inactive, you can plan for the surgical excision of the excess skin or the required ptosis correction. So next, it is very important to differentiate between the two ptosis, which occurs due to the dysfunction of levator complex, or the pseudoptosis, which is the false illusion of the lid to appears to be inferiorly displaced. So the lack of orbital volume due to anophthalmos, microphthalmos, and thyroid bulbi are the most common cause for the pseudoptosis. So you have to see and ask yourself, is it really a ptosis? Again, the post-traumatic anophthalmos also give appearance of the pseudoptosis, as you can see in the left eye. It is very important to document any malposition of eye, because especially the hypertropia and hypertrophia are associated, often associated in a case of ptosis. So here in the first case, the lower lid margin in both the eye, the upper lid margin in both the eyes, you can see slightly drooped from the normal position. In the second, the eyelid margin position is normal, but you can see the overlying hanging skin, which is very, it is excessive and lying over the upper eyelid lashes. In the third part, you can see the eyelid margin is at normal position and both the brows are getting drooped, mainly laterally. So it is very important to differentiate between all the three clinical entities, because the treatment differs significantly between all the three entities. So for the ptosis, ptosis correction is required. For the dermatocalysis, blepharoplasty is required. And for the broptosis, brow lift is required. If the patient is having all the three entities together, then we should try to consider brow lift first, followed by the correction of blepharoptosis and dermatocalysis. This gentleman presented with right eye ptosis, but the examination suggested left eye proptosis. His blood test suggestive of hyperthyroidism, and the CT scan revealed thyroid eye disease. So we have referred the patient to the endocrinologist. Similarly, this patient came with the left eye drooping, but you can notice there is a mild retraction in the right eye. There is a lid lag in the down gaze in the right eye, and there mild limitation in elevation as well as in abduction. This patient, when we examined the extremities, there was diffuse pigmentation all over with a pitting edema, and his blood test also was suggestive of hypothyroidism. So these cases are very important, and we should look at what is exactly the etiology of the ptosis, or if it is actually a ptosis or it's a pseudoptosis. So management is simple. Identification is the key, and you should treat the cause. So coming next to the other signs, you should look for the tone of orbicularis. You should rule out any pre-existing leg ophthalmos, because the ptosis surgery itself can be a potential risk for the leg ophthalmos. Here in this patient, you can see both eye leg ophthalmos. The exophthalmometry should be documented if needed. After the inspection of the periorbital area, it is important to do palpation of the eyelids and the orbital rim. In this patient, in the right eye, in the left eye, you can see diffuse swelling in the left side of the upper lid. In the second patient, the lid eversion reveals some mass in the conjunctival fornix in the lateral part. So both the palpation and lid eversion are very important in a case of ptosis. If the patient is presenting with a unilateral ptosis, it is mandatory to rule out the bilateral component. Here, when I am lifting the right eye, the ptotic right eye, then you can see the lid retraction in the left eye gets corrected automatically. Here in this video, I will show when I'm lifting the left eye up, the ptosis in the right eye gets enhanced. Hirschberg's test and cover-uncover test are very important to rule out strabismus in any patient of ptosis. Here in the first patient, there is right eye exotropia. In the second patient, there is right eye hypertropia. The third patient looks orthophoric in the primary position, but when we performed the cover-uncover test, you can see that both sides are getting dissociated, and there is the presence of alternative exotropia. And on a detailed history, the patient gives a history of intermittent exotropia. So extraocular movements are must to document in all the cases of ptosis, and these are especially affected in myasthenia, third the palsy, and CPEO. Diplopia charting should be done in required cases. The Bell's phenomena should be graded according to the part of cornea getting disappeared under the upper eyelid, and they are graded as good, fair, and poor. Along with this, the type of the Bell's should also be documented, whether it is normal, inverse, reverse, or perverse. The Bell's phenomena can be documented and can be performed by lifting the upper lid to the non-ptotic position, and then ask the patient to gently close the eye. You can watch the movement of the eyeball underneath, and then you can get an idea about the grading and type of the Bell's. So coming on to the measurements, there are two margin reflex distances, 1 and 2. So MRD1 is from the upper lid margin to the corneal light reflex, and MRD2 is from the lower lid margin to the corneal light reflex, as you can see in these two pictures. The palpable fissure height is from the upper lid margin to the lower lid margin when the axis passes through the corneal reflex. And you have to keep in mind that while taking these measurements, the eye should be in the primary position. So how lid position behaves in case of congenital and acquired ptosis. So in the first patient, you can see that the palpable fissure height increases more in the down gaze in comparison to the primary gaze due to failure of relaxation of the LPS muscle. While in the second patient, you can see the palpable fissure height in the down gaze is lesser in comparison to the primary gaze. So these relative difference in both the vertical fissure height gives an idea of the etiology of the ptosis. So on the basis of severity, the ptosis are divided into mild, moderate, and severe. In the first patient, you can see there is around 2 millimeter less than 2 millimeter of the droop. In the second patient, there is around 3 millimeter. And in the third patient, the droop is around 4 millimeter or more, which are suggestive of the severe ptosis. A very important point here to mention is you should always rule out compensatory lid retraction of the contralateral upper eyelid before documenting the severity of the ptosis. So the levator function in adults is measured by Burpee's method, where the patient is asked to look down and then extreme down gaze and from here to extreme up gaze while negating the frontalis action, and head position should be in the frontal plane. So the levator exertion are divided into poor, fair, good and excellent depending on the exertion. In infants and young children who are not cooperative for this Burpee's method, a head posture and frontalis overaction give us an idea about the levator function. If it is a well-formed lid crease, it suggests that the levator action might be better in such case. The ellipse sign can be documented by averting the eyelid of the baby when she is looking down. And if it is this aversion is getting automatically corrected, then it means that the baby is having a good levator function. So in upper lid crease, you should document the presence, position, and multiplicity of the lid crease. So the lid crease is generally absent in the congenital ptosis, and they are at a higher level in the upper neuritic defect. There are two entities to measure here are marginal crease distance, which is measured in the down gaze, which is showing in the first photograph. So we have to measure from the margin to lid crease in the down gaze, and it is around 6 to 8 millimeters in males and 8 to 10 millimeters in females. The second important documentation is the pre-tarsal show, where we have to measure the distance between the lid margin and the skin fold in the primary position. Here you can see the patient is having left eye increased pre-tarsal show in comparison to the right eye. So the Schirmer's and Tebert test are very important along with the corneal sensation to rule out any dryness. And the visual field testing should be done in the patient for the documentation of the loss of superior field or is there any defect. Phenylephrine test is usually performed to see whether the Müller's muscle surgery is feasible in a case of ptosis or not. Here you can see that the left eye ptosis, which is mild, is getting automatically corrected after the instillation of phenylephrine 2.5%, and the right eye is showing lid retraction now. So the systematic examination should include best corrected visual acuity and cycloplegic refraction, especially in the children. The anterior segment examination should be comprehensive with special emphasis to the pupils, which are involved with the Horner's and Thurnham palsy. And the posterior segment examination should rule out any abnormal retinal pigmentation or Kearns iris syndrome. Along with this, if the patient is having any systemic features, then a systemic or neurological examination is must. So after the thorough history and examination, let's do a quick assessment and make a working diagnosis. So you have to mention all these things, whether it is unilateral, bilateral, the congenital acquired, whether it is acute or chronic, progressive, non-progressive, it is isolated or complex, which leads towards the etiological diagnosis. And now I am discussing one by one each of them. So the myogenic ptosis in children is isolated congenital. It is most common ptosis in children. It generally presents at birth or soon after the birth. Generally, they have LPS dysgenesis or fatty infiltration with reduction in the muscle fibers. They can be autosomal dominant or sporadic. Unilateral is more common. If they are bilateral, then it can be asymmetric or symmetric. Here, due to fatty infiltration, the LPS fails to relax so that there is a lid lag on the down gaze. So in contrast to the congenital ptosis, which is very common in children, if the child is presenting with acquired ptosis, then you should rule out any severe or serious disease cause, such as metabolic, neuromuscular, muscular, or traumatic cause. So it is documented that 16% of the ptosis have associated ipsilateral superior rectus muscle weakness. So it is mandatory to perform extraocular movement check in all the patient. Here you can see the patient is having right eye hypertropia and he is having the limitation in the up case. The unilateral cases of the ptosis also are associated with amblyopia if they are mild or if they are moderate to severe. So what are the indication for intervention in case of congenital ptosis? So if the visual axis is obscured, as in the second picture, if there is an abnormal head posture, if there is any amblyopia due to deprivation or induced astigmatism, any presence of strabismus, if it is affecting the psychology of the patient and patient is getting depressed by it, then it has to be done. And for the cosmetic purpose, if it is unilateral, patient generally seek treatment for that. So how soon it should be done? If it is there is deprivation amblyopia or any type of amblyopia, it is must to do as soon as possible. The type of surgery depends generally on the elevator action and the presence of other complex diseases such as BPAs and Marcus Gunn. And if it is unilateral surgery, ptosis, whether unilateral or bilateral frontalis sling surgery is required, it is a controversial issue. But the patient, in all cases of ptosis, the very important aspect of counseling the parents is to advise for the need of amblyopia treatment after surgery. So in the bilateral congenital ptosis, if it is mild, can be observed, and cosmetically, if need, can be corrected. If it is moderate, with a fair LPS action, you can plan for the simultaneous bilateral LPSR. If it is severe, bilateral simultaneous sling can be planned. If it is unilateral, mild, we can observe. If it is moderate, the LPSR can be done. If it is severe, then a temporary frontalis sling surgery can be done when this child is very small. Later, during the teen and adulthood, we can try and give more cosmetically better appearance by the permanent surgeries, which can be a supramaximal LPSR or vitinal sling. Here, this patient is having bilateral severe ptosis, and we can see that how nicely he gets corrected of his head posture and visual axis after bilateral sling surgery. This is the unilateral ptosis in the left eye getting improved nicely after the silicone sling. This is the patient with right eye ptosis. Here, I have done the levator dissection surgery, and the patient improved nicely and with a nice lid contour and height. So there is another entity which is known as congenital cranial disinnervation disorder, which happens due to the dysgenetic nuclei in the brain. And here they have abnormal innervation of the ocular muscles. These include DRS, BPAS, CFUM, and Marcus Gunn jaw winking phenomena. So in blepharophimosis or BPAS syndrome, there is a component of phimosis, that is the vertical as well as horizontal phimosis or shortening of the eyelid, along with the severe ptosis, which is generally bilateral. And there is presence of epicanthal inversus as well, which is the fold of excess skin in the lower lid going towards the upper lid, crossing the medial canthus, though this patient is not having this. There is associated telecanthus and hypertelorism in such cases, and patient may have hypoplasia of the superior orbital rim and the nasal ridges. So it has a genetic component, and type 1 variant of this disease generally have premature ovarian failure. So a gynecological consultation is must to do in such cases. The treatment by different authors and different surgeons, it has been described as single stage or multiple stage, both give good results. So in either of the procedures, we have to correct the horizontal deformity first, and then you have to correct the ptosis correction in the second part. So now coming on to the Marcus Gunn jaw winking syndrome, which is also a type of complex ptosis. This is a congenital synkinesis, which happens due to the miscommunication between cranial nerve 3 and cranial nerve 5. It can involve either of the masticatory muscles. So in any case of unilateral ptosis, we should document and rule out the Marcus Gunn jaw winking syndrome not only by eating or allowing the patient to eat, but you have to do the different maneuvers to rule out any minimal syncinesis. So you can ask the patient to open the mouth, you can ask the patient to do a jaw, contralateral jaw movement, or you can ask the patient to protect the jaw. Here you can see the patient is having variable ptosis in the initial first two pictures. So you should suspect Marcus Gunn in patient with the variable ptosis and variable levator action. When the patient is asked to eat something, you can see how nicely it is getting improved. So the syncinesis is grading subjectively depending on the maximum elevation of the totic eyelid and objectively depending on the range of syncinesis. In our patient, you can see the eyelid is going beyond the superior limbus with an objective range of 5 millimeter or more with the scleral show in the left eye. So it is the severe grading. So the acquired ptosis, acquired myogenic ptosis, in contrast to the congenital ptosis, are rare. They happen due to the dysfunction of LPS. They can happen in children or adults, both. There is generally progressive ptosis, often associated with other muscle dysfunction systemically, and they have variable levator actions. The common ones are myasthenia and CPEO. So myasthenia, as you all know, it happens due to autoantibodies against acetylcholine receptor. They present with variable weakness of the skeletal muscle. Females are more commonly involved. 50 to 80% of the ocular myasthenia develop generalized stasis over a period of time. They generally present with the facial weakness, proximal limb weakness, difficulty in swallowing and breathing, and the symptoms are typically intermittent. So if there is any respiratory compromise in such patient, it is the life-threatening condition. So generally the patient have bilateral asymmetrical presentation, and the ptosis and diplopia can be initial sign of the disease in 50% of the patients. So if the elevator muscle is involved in myasthenia, then it gives rise to the variable ptosis, which worsens with the fatigue and evening and improves with the rest. If the extraocular muscles are involved, then it gives rise to the variable diplopia and strabismus. If the myasthenia is involving the orbicularis muscle, the patient may present with eyelid retraction and orbicularis weakness with a peak sign. So here you can see the patient is having bilateral severe ptosis with strabismus and almost limited extraocular movement in all the cases. So here in this video, I'm showing the demonstration of the variability and the fatigue test. You can see that the patient is having the variable ptosis in the right eye with the different levels at different time. When the patient is asked for up and down, then you can see the ptosis worsens. In this video, I am demonstrating the rest test. So after 30 minutes of rest, you can see how nicely the ptosis is improved in the right side, and over a period of time, it is getting worsened. The Kogan's lid twitch sign is demonstrated by asking the patient to look straight from the downward position when he has seen the downward position for at least 15 seconds. So you will see a overshoot of the upper lid when the patient moves the eyes from the downward gaze to the primary gaze. Here, when the patient is coming to the primary gaze, you can see there is a quick twitch or overshoot in the right eye upper lid. So eyes test also gives idea about the myasthenia. This is the patient showing pre and post eyes pack test. And you can see the improvement in the ptosis in both the sides. The Nystagmus test can be performed, and around 20 to 30 minutes after the Nystagmus administration IM, you can see the improvement in the ptosis and in extraocular movements if they are present. So still, if you are not sure if the cause of ptosis is myasthenia, then you can go ahead with the repetitive nerve stimulation study. This is the RNS study of the patient with eye specter positive. Here you can show, here you can see that the right eye is showing decremental response in the RNS study, while the left eye, there is no such abnormality. You can also perform single nerve muscle fiber EMG and the anti-acetylcholine receptor antibodies, which are almost 100% specific, but they may absent in some cases of ocular myasthenia gravis. So if the myasthenia is newly diagnosed, then you should perform a CT or MRHS to rule out thymoma. If there is any signs or symptoms of respiratory compromise, then immediate neurological evaluation and hospital admission should be advised. Primary treatment for the myasthenia is the pharmacological treatment with pyridostigmine and prednisolone. Surgery is generally performed in the stable and refractory cases after maximal medical improvement. Generally, we perform a reversible sling surgery with a deliberate undercorrection because they have high risk of exposure keratopathy and meniscus diplopia. If the ptosis is very severe with absent bowels and poor orbicularis function, ptosis crutches can be given. And it is very important to counsel the patient that the disease is progressive and they can frequently recur after the initial surgery. So these are the crutch classes. You can see in the upper part of the frame, there is a hook which fits in the superior sulcus and give the appearance of lifted eyelid. So the next is this chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, CPEO, where the patient generally presents with the bilateral symmetric ptosis. So they have ophthalmoplegia without any diplopia. They begin in childhood and adulthood, and they're gradually progressive. They can be 50% hereditary. So here you can see the patient with bilateral severe ptosis with extraocular movement limitation in almost all the directions. These are the association we should rule out in all the cases of CPEO. The muscle biopsy is the confirmatory diagnosis in case of CPEO. The multifocal ERG, ECG, and neurological consult should be performed in the patient who have the significant associations. So the treatment includes addressing the systemic abnormality first, followed by the surgery with the sling, with a deliberate undercorrection and crutch classes. So now coming to the upper neurotic ptosis, which is the most common type of the ptosis, which happens due to stretching, attenuation, dehiscence, disinsertion of the LPS upper neurosis from its tarsal attachments. The involution ptosis is most common. They typically have normal LPS function, normal extraocular movements and pupils. They have laxity in the skin. The lid crease is generally at a higher level, and they may have some multiple lid creases. There is generally a deeper superior sulcus. Here in this patient, you can see in the right eye, there is a ptosis, which is due to constant contact lens usage. Patient may have ptosis due to excessive rubbing, as this patient is having in the left eye. The intraocular surgery also have been described to have effect on the lid, and the incidence of ptosis following the cataract surgery has been mentioned up to 21%. It can be multifactorial, and there are multiple theories have been given in the literature. They can be transient, which improves over a period of several weeks, or it can be persistent, which persists more than 6 months. So they typically have minimal or no impairment in the levator function. For these situations, we have to wait for at least 6 months to 1 year. The spontaneous return of levator function, this intraocular complex in the cell correction after the ptosis surgery with the levator attachment. So the treatment of upper neurotic ptosis depends on the severity of the ptosis. If it is moderate to severe, LPS reattachment or resection can be performed. If it is mild, molarectomy can be done. They generally have excellent prognosis. Here is the patient with bilateral severe ptosis. And I have performed a bilateral levator resection surgery in this patient. And this is particularly very close to my heart, because this patient says when he travels or when he has to walk, he has to take help from his family members and relatives. But after the ptosis surgery, the patient's visual axis got so clear, and he can walk around without any support, and he is very happy about it and very thankful for this. So the another type is the third nerve palsy. We can help, which can happen due to various reasons. It can be partial or complete. They generally have ptosis. They can have diplopia. If there is a complete ptosis, there will be no diplopia. They can have external ophthalmoplegia and mydriasis. Here in this patient, you can see there is right eye a severe ptosis with down and eye out eyeball. The movements are limited in all the directions. So how to proceed with the third nerve palsy? So if it is pupil involving third nerve palsy, emergent neuroimaging with MR angiography or CT angiography is advisable. If it is non-resolving palsy over a 3 months period or develops pupillary involvement during the course, incomplete palsy, palsy with the aberrant regeneration, neuroimaging is advisable. Young patient less than 50 years of age, unless they are not having any significant vascular disease, neuroimaging is advised. If the patient is presenting with complete palsy and no anisocorial presentation, the frequent follow-up is not necessary and these patients can be closely observed. So in cases of third nerve palsy, first and foremost is to find out the cause, wait for 6 to 12 months for observation, because there is high chances of spontaneous recovery of nerve and the LPS muscle. Till the time, you can give the patient with the unilateral patching in mild to moderate cases where they have diplopia. If you are planning for the surgical intervention after an observation period, you should look for the bells. And if there is a poor bells, then you should advise for the strabismal surgery first. And for the residual ptosis, you can plan for the frontalis suspension with a silicone rod. The next neurological ptosis is Horner syndrome. It can be congenital or acquired, and there are multiple of causes for these in adults and children. So the in Horner's, in which is what is relevant in the talk of ptosis, is they have generally mild ptosis in the upper lid with good LPS action, and their lower lid also has slight reverse ptosis. You can see in the left eye here, they have meiosis and anisocoria is more than the darkness. The upper lid and the lower lid ptosis give a picture of apparent inophthalmos. The pharmacological testing has already been explained in details by Dr. Soumya. So what to do next in a case of Horner syndrome? So if it is a recently diagnosis, you have to perform neural imaging of the neck and brain and the CT chest. And the mild ptosis in these cases can be dealt very nicely by the Mullerectomy surgery. Coming on to the traumatic ptosis, they can happen due to muscle transection or aponeurosis disinsertion or third nerve damage. Detailed assessment should include any residual swelling, scarring, leg ophthalmos. And one point you should remember is any injury that suggests the direct cutting of the levator should have exploration of the levator at the time of trauma if possible. So many of the times we see a through full thickness cut of the eyelid near the sulcus and the above the level of tarsal plate, then you should think of any injury to the or direct cut to the levator. If it is not there, you can just observe for 3 to 6 months for the spontaneous recovery, and then you can see a very nice improvement in the left eye in this patient. So the mechanical ptosis can happen due to n number of reasons, similar to the news about the coronavirus, which are spreading throughout the social media. So there are n number of reasons, which includes the hodiolums, any lacrimal gland prolapses, blepharochalasis, dermatochalasis, etc. So for the mechanical ptosis, treat the cause. It can be by the medical treatment or the surgical treatment, and correct the residual ptosis by the levator advancement or resection. So the optimal surgical approach in a patient of ptosis depends on its etiology, its severity, levator function, safety of the surgery, and the expected outcomes. And you should clarify with the patient that what is the primary objective for the surgery, whether the patient wants only functional improvement or he is concerned for the cosmesis. So, and you should keep in mind that the perfection is an unreasonable goal in a case of ptosis. The surgical approach of the ptosis depends on the degree of the ptosis and the vital function. So if it is a severe ptosis with poor LPS action, the common surgery is the frontalis sling. If it is mild to severe ptosis with LPS action 4 to 10, then levator resection or advancement can be tried. If it is mild ptosis with excellent levator action, then a Fasanella serviette and Muller resection surgery can be planned. So there is a lot of confusion about the ideal sling material among the residents because they keep seeing different materials in different textbooks. So you have to think that each of them have their advantages and disadvantages. And the commonly used sling materials are facial lata in the autogenous material and silicone sling in synthetic materials. They are not ideal, but are near ideal. Similar to the materials, there are different techniques described for the sling surgeries. Out of them, the two common methods are the pentagon, box pentagon, and the Crawford triangle methods. And the author in this article has described that the lid contour is better in the Crawford triangle. Double triangle methods. And then their expertise and their preference of the surgeries. So coming on to the advantages of the silicone rod, it can be done in any age group. It is cheap and inert and easily available. There is no second surgical site required. They have great leak closure and easy post-op adjustability can be done, and they are frequently reversible, which are important in cases of third nerve palsy, myasthenia, CPO. But on the downside, they have infection. They can have exposure, extrusion, and granuloma formation. They can break and they can lead to recurrence up to 30%. So this is the surgery I have done with ethibond suture in a child during my fellowship. So here you can see that I have marked the five I think there is some technical glitch.
Dr. Shweta, could you just go to the previous slide and start again?
Yeah, as I already mentioned, the advantages and disadvantages of the silicone rod. Now I'm showing the surgery of tarsoplantar sling with ethibond. Here I have done the five different markings. The upper lid markings are done in line with the limbus, medial and lateral, around 2 millimeter above the lid margin. Two lateral incisions are marked in line with the medial and lateral canthus, just above the eyebrow, and keeping in mind to safeguard the eyebrow hair follicles here. And the central one, it's generally made in between the two lateral ones, around 1 to 1.5 millimeter above the eyebrow. Now it's important to give local infiltration. Even the patient is in general anesthesia because it provides a good hemostasis. After that, I am putting the ointment for the lubrication. 3 stair incisions are given in the forehead, in the already marked areas till the level of periosteum. You should maintain the hemostasis here, and if there is any bleeding, you should just press it. In the upper lid incision, it should be just a scratch incision and not the deep ones. Now I am passing the Ithibond suture from the central deep incision and taking it out from the lateral one. And now after that, we will complete the whole pentagon. From here, we will take out from the lateral incision here. Then we will pass through the subcorbicularis plane. The plane is very important here. And now we are taking it out from the lid incision. From the same incision, we have to again put down the needle and pass through the pretarsal tissue. Here it is very important to not to perforate the tarsal plate. And it is important to look for any full thickness perforation by gentle eversion of the now. Here my assistant is seeing whether the pass is full thickness or not. The presence of lid guard is of utmost importance in this step to prevent any injury to the cornea. Here, now I am passing this towards the medial side and taking out from the lateral incision and finally from the superior incision. Here, as I'm using Ithibond, I have not made any pocket in the superior incision, but if you are using a silicone rod or fascia lata, it is very important to make a pocket superiorly so that we can bury the silicone rod ends and the fascia lata through that opening, and they can be safely secured there without causing any exposure or extrusion. So here, just taking out the suture from the 1 centimeter superior portion is just enough. Now we are closing. It is in 2 layers, the subcutaneous tissue and the superficial skin. All the 3 incisions in the forehead should be closed meticulously. After that, I am putting the frost suture. It is very important in case of congenital ptosis, operated under general anesthesia. Similarly, we are closing the wound of the left eye. And after putting the ointment, we are keeping both the frost sutures over the forehead to secure them. This is the patient with post-operative silicone sling with very nice correction. This is the patient with unilateral sling in the right eye. Then you can see it is nicely closing. And there is no leg of thalamus. So coming on to the fascia lata, it is easily available. The bump over the brow is less palpable few years later in cases of fascia lata because it is an absorbable material. It has minimum recurrence and minimum resurgery rates, but there is a slight transient leg discomfort and scar in the legs, and it can cause sometimes a long-lasting leg of thalamus. So this is the surgery I have done under endoscopic guidance, and I was fortunate enough to do this fascia lata surgery under the guidance of Dr. Milind. So here, as we enter into the subcutaneous tissue, you can see glistening fatty tissue. Here you can see the fascia lata fibers. We will mark 2 parallel lines here and incise them, and we will cut till we are sure that we have achieved the adequate length. Here we are separating from the around the tissue in and around. Here we are carrying out blunt dissection in the superior part of the front, the fascia lata. You can see a nice strip is there. This is the inferior part of the fascia lata where we are separating from the underlying muscles. Now, when you are sure that you have achieved adequate length, you can cut it, separate from the remaining fascia, and you can take it out. Here you can see a long length of fascia latae. Generally, we take 15 centimeter of the fascia latae. And the thickness depends on whether we are doing unilateral surgery or a bilateral surgery. So it can be from 5 millimeter to the 10 millimeter width of the fascia latae. So this is the steps of surgery while we do the sling surgery with fascia latae. The difference is that we start here from the upper lid crease with the help of right needle. We put the fascia latae along the upper lid incisions. Here you can see we have threaded the fascia latae through the upper lid crease tunnel. Then we will pass the needle from the forehead incision and we'll take out the fascia latae from there and completing the similar Fox Pentagon method. And we'll complete here. And now I'm placing the knot. And after I'm assured that I have achieved the desired length, which is left generally at the superior limbus in case of fascia latae, I'm just tightening the 2-3 knots so that it will be secured. After that, I'm securing it with the Vicryn suture and burying it in the under the pocket. Here it is very important to bury, which I explained earlier, so that there will be no chance of extrusion or exposure and the wound is closed in two layers. So this is the patient with bilateral severe ptosis after fascia latae surgery. You can see how the eyebrows especially are getting corrected after the surgery, and the patient need not to use his brows now because this is already taken care by the sling from the frontalis muscles. So now coming on to the levator resection surgery. This is the surgery done by Dr. Milind. So here, after proper marking of the lid crease, which is generally matched with the other eye, we have to give a small incision. It can be done with the radiofrequency cautery, or it can be done a 15 number blade. After that, we have to do a dissection of this orbicularis. Now, the dissection is meticulously carried out under the orbicularis plane and the tarsal plate is exposed. Now we are giving the slight amount, so 0.1 millimeter of local infiltration just to make sure the patient is comfortable. And now we are passing the traction suture for the eyelid retraction so that we'll get a good exposure. Here we are separating the levator muscle by sublevator dissection from the underlying Müller's muscle and the conjunctiva. And you have to make sure you are not going full thickness here because you can touch the cornea. After separating the levator from the underlying tissue from all the sides, we will do epilevator dissection where we will separate the levator from the overlying structures. Now we are opening the septum. Septum is generally in the multiple layers. So you have to make sure you have properly dissected and completely dissected the septum throughout the length of the eyelid. And it will be, you can ensure this by seeing the pre-epineuritic fat pad. You can see here superiorly. So this is the confirmation that you have reached in the correct plane. So before the cardinal suture, you can see the lid height. Now we will put the central cardinal suture. We'll pass through the levator muscle. Then we will pass this through the superior portion just around 2-3 millimeter from the superior border of the tarsus, around 90% of the thickness of the tarsus. Some people pass from the pretarsal tissue as well. So you have to make sure that there is no full thickness perforation at this step. And now again, you can pass through the levator muscle. This is the type of horizontal matrix suture. And now you can put a temporary knot here and you can see So this is before the cardinal suture. Now we are placing the slip knot. It is a type of temporary knot. Just to see whether you have achieved and you have corrected what you have desired preoperatively. If you are assured about your lid height, you can pass the similar sutures medially and laterally. The central one we pass generally from the center of the eyelid, or if it is there is a different contour of the eyelid, we have to adjust according to the eyelid contour. There is a lateral room, we will try to put the lateral sutures slightly laterally, and generally we put the medial and lateral sutures at the junction of middle one third and medial one third, and middle one third and lateral one third for both the lateral and medial cardinal sutures. So after we have put the cardinal sutures and we are sure that we have achieved the desired height, here this nicely corrected lid margin height. Now we will tighten it and secure permanent knots. And after this cutting, we have to remove the levator stump just below the cardinal sutures. And with this levator stump, we have to leave around 1 millimeter to 2 millimeter, and which helps in forming the lid crease sutures. Lid crease is formed by passing the suture through the levator, through the orbicularis. And different people have different techniques here. Some people pass from levator, orbicularis, levator. Some people will pass only from the lower edge of the orbicularis with the levator. But whatever works best for you, you can try for that. And here you can see nicely corrected ptosis. And after completing the lid crease formation suture, the eyelid is closed with the continuous 6-O-proline sutures. So you can see a nice correction in the ptosis after the surgery. So the third surgery is the Fasciolaris Abbott. It's a Tarsoconjunctivomullarectomy surgery. It corrects up to 2 millimeter ptosis. And we can generally do it in the 10 millimeter of levator actions minimum. Here it is the excision of the tarsal plate, upper back border of the tarsal plate, lower border of the Müller's muscle, and the conjunctiva. So this we will cut and we will suture it back. Generally, it depends on the surgeon's choice. Few surgeons are not doing it. Few sutures are very comfortable with doing it. So it depends on the surgeon's discretion. So the Marcus gun jaw winking, it's a complicated type of ptosis, and spatial surgical consideration should be taken care of. You should decide which is more significant, and you should involve the parents in the counseling, and you should ask them whether the ptosis or the syncytiasis is affecting them more. What is the severity of ptosis and the severity of synkinetic movement? So if it is the mild syncytiasis, mild ptosis with mild syncytiasis, you can observe or you can do ptosis correction alone. If it is ptosis with moderate to large syncytiasis, there are different opinions about the both unilateral LPS excision with sling surgery, bilateral levator excision with unilateral sling surgery, and bilateral levator excision with bilateral sling surgery. And it depends on the surgeon's choice again and what works best in their hands. But in always, you should document and you should mention and you should counsel the parents about the post-operative increase in the synkinetic movement after the surgery. So in surgical management, it all depends on the risk and benefit, and you have to see which condition is, which situation and which surgical procedure works best in your hands. So to summarize, the pupil and extraocular movement assessment are crucial in ptosis evaluation. The management starts only after the etiology is confirmed. The surgical technique depends on different parameters, which we have already described, and the surgeon's choice. And in the end, counsel till the patient understands about all the sequelae and the complication and the realistic expectations. So to take home, you have to see, is it a ptosis? What about the pupil? How are the extraocular movements? And where did it come? Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shweta. It's been a wonderful presentation with lots of pictures and depicting almost all the conditions which are known to cause ptosis. Very nice presentation. We have some questions.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, we have some questions. Dr. Srinivas would want to know that in CPEO, when you want to plan a muscle biopsy, which muscle biopsy would you prefer?
If you're planning, you can take from the orbicularis directly. If you are seeing that other muscles are also involved in CPEO, then generally we prefer from the levator. So we can take from the muscle, not from the epiluresis. So you have to reach at a height above the vitnals to get the proper biopsy specimen.
Right. Dr. Anant Singhi wants to know, what is the ideal age at which a child has to be operated if he's having congenital ptosis, but there is no risk of amblyopia?
If there is no no risk of amblyopia, then you can wait for at least 3 to 4 years of age till the time the patient will be comfortable for the preoperative measurements and the postoperative follow-ups. Then that time you can plan. And if it is mild ptosis, they are not cosmetically concerned, then you can plan in the teenage when the patient is more, we can have a full growth of the face and you can avoid the need for the multiple surgeries. So for the amblyopia, you can try as soon as possible. Otherwise, at least you should wait for 3 to 4 years of age. If you're planning for facial atta surgery, to be very specific, you have to wait and you should wait till 4 years of age so that we will have a full development of all the muscles and fascia in the extremities.
Right. I want to add Dr. Shweta to this. Dr. Anant, whenever we're planning for a ptosis surgery in a patient with congenital ptosis with no amblyopia, why we choose 4 years is because that's a preschool age. Well, you can have a child who's going a little early or a little later. The reason why we choose a preschool age is because, or just before they want to go to school, is because children can have a lot of psychological issues because they look different. So children who look different tend to be neglected by other children and they can have severe psychosocial problems. That's the reason why we tend to intervene just before they starting school. That's why the age is about 4 years and they tend to be very cooperative in giving the good assessment too. Thank you. Dr. Preeti wants to know what preventive measures a cataract surgeon should need to know to avoid risk of ptosis in patient.
So there are multiple theories has been explained which causes transient and persistent ptosis. I have given the link there. You can just go through the articles. But to just summarize, there are the different effects due to local anesthesia, if you are giving a peribulbar anesthesia, if there is any hematoma in the surgery, if you are putting any suture which can irritate the levator muscle. And again, one most important thing is the method of application of the speculum also affects affects the LPS and superior rectus muscle complex. So if it is very tight speculum, then it can lead to the slight injury to the superior rectus muscle and levator complex. Then if there is an injury, then it can lead to a ptosis. If you are doing an SICA surgery and you are doing a superior rectus bridle, then it can cause injury to the levator muscle. So it is lesser in cases if we are operating under topical anesthesia, because there will be no side effects from the levator damage due to local anesthetic agents. You should always document if there is any pre-existing ptosis, because generally I see many of the patients, they just come and they tell that the ptosis and this drooping happened only after the surgery. So as a cataract surgeon, you have to and you should mention if there is any mild ptosis component so that you can show the patient by their photographs that there is a pre-existing ptosis and you can counsel the patient accordingly.
Right. Dr. Debangshu has a question. He's asking, when you're performing frontalis sling with an ethy bond, what is the size of the needle and what is the suture grade? And how do you decide that?
Suture grade, because we need for the frontalis surgery, we need a tough suture. So we use 3-0 and 4-0. If child is around more than a year of age, we generally prefer 3-0 suture. And if it is like less than a year, we use 4-0 suture. The advantages of ethybond suture here are it is the cheaper in comparison to the silicone, and it is having less chances of recurrence and slippage. So if we are taking the patient under the general anesthesia, a small child, which want to avoid the repeated surgeries, then we can consider for the ethybond suture. The needle comes inbuilt with the ethybond suture and we are not using any separate needle.
Right. Dr. Preeti has two questions. She's asking whether you can explain the physiology and mechanism of Bell's. Dr. Preeti, I think it will be beyond the session. So we'll skip this question. You can ask her personally. The other question is how astigmatism and ptosis are related, except in patients with allergy or VKC.
So the ptosis generally cause some compression of the superior part of the cornea. So generally it leads to with the rule type of astigmatism. And so we have to lift the eyelid whenever we are checking the refraction or doing a cyclorefraction in a patient. You should lift the eyelid and then do the refraction. Also, you can do a pentachem to or any corneal topography to see any refractive error or any astigmatism existing there. So.
Right. Okay. Dr. Sri Ramcharan has a question. He says his doubt is regarding MRD1. He says, during evaluation for MRD1, do we negate the levator palpebrae superioris action before measurement in primary case?
You have not exactly to negate the levator action. You have to negate the frontalis action actually, and you have to make sure that the eyebrow is at the normal level. So if you are positioning in the side of the ptosis where you are measuring the MRD1, you have to fix the eyebrow and then you have at the normal position in comparison to the other eye, then you have to measure the MRD1 so that you will get the correct severity, rather than if it is due to a lifted eyebrow, then you will get a false low MRD1.
Right. Dr. Preeti wants to know that when you're doing a frontalis sting under GA, you would be marking the your incisions before induction of GA.
Dr. Preeti, if we are doing a frontalis sling surgery in a child, if he is cooperative, then you can plan in the sitting position. But generally, if we are operating the patient under general anesthesia, we prefer to do the marking in the lying down position only, because it's hardly affect. It's hardly affect the position of the markings, and there is not much difference in the two entities. But definitely for the levator surgeries, as we are marking the lid crease, we should prefer the sitting position.
And she would also want to know, when you're doing the measurements, is there any specification for eyelash line or the gray line? I think she wants to know something about eyelash ptosis, I guess.
So you have to pass the sutures 2 millimeter above the eyelid margin. And if you will go more less, like more inferiorly or more superiorly to this, then you cannot get a good lesh contour later. And if you are having lesh ptosis, which is common in cases of a frontalis sling and supramaximal levator resection, you can do a tarsal rotation. You can place a tarsal rotation suture, or you can excise a part of skin orbicularis just above the lid crease so that it will cause a scarring there and will not cause a lid ptosis.
Right. Dr. Anand would want to know, what is a basic guideline or management for ptosis in a 3-year-old?
The guideline as such should start from the history and examination, which I have already covered. And after you have done the thorough history taken all the measurements and rule out all the other significant or serious causes, then you can look at my slide of the indications for the intervention. So if there is any indication is existing, then you can think of going and planning for the surgery. And if there is no such case and you can wait, then it is better to wait for the surgery till the patient ages to 3 to 4 years of age.
Right. Thank you very much, Dr. Shweta. It's been a wonderful talk, wonderful pictures and videos. Really enjoyed the talk.
Thank you so much, sir.
And I'm sure the DNB students and the fellows will definitely benefit out of this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
And for tomorrow's session, we'll be having a discussion on posterior uveitic entities, which will be presented by a consultant in uvea and retina services, Dr. Nidhi, who is a consultant in retina and uvea services at Shankar Eye Hospital, Bangalore. The link remains the same. And the time is 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. So thank you all and stay safe and goodbye.